Good morning, and welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation at Willamette Falls. We invite you to go find a chalice or a candle in your home and light it as we light our chalice here. And I invite you to join in our chalice lighting statement. Whoever you are, wherever or whatever you come from, you are welcome here, where we are invited into connection and inspired to spiritual growth. Let us leave this hour together, refreshed anew, ready to ignite action for justice in the wider world. Announcement, right after this service today, right after our postlude, I'm going to invite everyone to stay on, even if you don't stay on for virtual coffee hour. I'm going to invite you to stay on, and we are going to have a tiny practice of the voting for our annual meeting next week. Our annual meeting will be held next week on Zoom. Right after the service. The service will be a little shorter than usual, so we can get started with our meeting a little earlier. We will talk about the budget and vote to elect new board members and new members of our nominating team. We will also recognize some key volunteers over the course of the year and just celebrate briefly together as a community all that we have done this last year. Our opening words this morning are from the Reverend Scott Taylor, who writes, "Let us be real." You can remove it now, that mask handed to you by the world. You can stop repeating, I'm fine," when all your heart wants to say is, "I hurt." You can forget those hoops. Let someone else jump through them for a change. Here, the striving can stop. The pretending can be put away. Here, just for a moment, let us be real. Come, let us worship together. I invite you to join us in our opening hymn, Gaudeamus Hodie, and our music director, Allison, is going to introduce this.
Good morning, everybody. In case you're not familiar with Gaudeamus Hodie, it is a three-part song, so you're going to hear me sing it through each different part one time through, and then pick a part, sing through all of them, do whatever you like. You'll hear something you can sing to as we go along. So let's go ahead and begin the hymn.
Gaudeamus
Allison, and thank you for singing at home. It's time for all ages now, and so if you have little ones in your home, I invite you to bring them up here in front of the screen, and I'm going to tell them a story about six blind men and an elephant. There are many ways of telling this story, and this is the one that the Peace Corps uses to train their volunteers. See if you can think why they might want Peace Corps volunteers to hear a story like this. So long ago, six old blind men lived in a village in India. And they were each born blind. They had never seen. And the other villagers loved the old men and they kept them from any harm. And since the blind men couldn't see the world for themselves, they had to imagine its many wonders. And they listened carefully to the stories that the travelers told them to learn what they could about life outside the village. Men were curious about many of the stories that they heard, but they were most curious about elephants. They were told that elephants could trample forests, could carry huge burdens, and could frighten the young and the old with their loud trumpeting calls. But they also knew that the Raja's daughter rode an elephant when she traveled in her father's kingdom. And so why would the Raja let his daughter get near such a dangerous creature? They argued day and night about elephants. And finally, the villagers grew tired of the arguments. And they arranged for the curious men to visit the palace of the Raja to learn the truth about elephants. A young boy from their village was selected to guide the blind men on their journey. The smallest man put his hand on the boy's shoulder. The second blind man put his hand on his friend's shoulder, and so on until all six men were ready to walk safely behind the boy who would lead them to the Raja's magnificent palace. When the blind men reached the palace, they were greeted by an old friend from the village who worked as a gardener on the palace grounds. Their friend led them to the courtyard, and there stood an elephant. Well, the men couldn't see the elephant, so they reached forward to touch this creature that they had had so many arguments about. The first man reached out and he touched the side of the huge animal. An elephant is smooth and solid like a wall, he said. It must be very powerful. The second blind man put his hand on the elephant's trunk. He said, an elephant is like a giant snake. The third man felt the elephant's pointed tusk. This creature is as sharp and deadly as a spear, he said. And the fourth blind man touched one of the elephant's legs. He said, why, it's just a gigantic cow. And the fifth blind man felt the elephant's huge ear. And he said, I think the elephant is like a big fan, or maybe a magic carpet that can fly over mountains and treetops. And the sixth man gave a tug on the elephant's tail. And he said, why, this is just a piece of old rope. I think we've all been fooled. The gardener led his friends to the shade of a tree, and he said, sit here and rest for the long journey home. I'll bring you some water to drink. And while they waited, the six blind men talked about the elephant. An elephant is like a wall, the first man said. Surely we can agree on that. A wall? The elephant is a giant snake, said the second man. It's a spear, I tell you, said the third. No, I am certain it is a giant cow, said the fourth man. It's a magic carpet, there's no doubt, said the fifth man. Don't you see, pleaded the sixth blind man, someone used a rope to trick us. And their argument continued until their shouts grew louder and louder. Wall, snake, cow, spear, rope, carpet. Stop shouting, called a very angry voice. It was the Raja, awakened from his nap by the noisy argument. How can each of you be so certain you are right? Said the ruler. And the six blind men considered the question. After all, the Raja was a very wise man. And so they decided just to be quiet. The elephant is a very large animal, said the Raja kindly. Each person only touched one part. Perhaps if you put the parts together, you could see the truth. Now let me finish my nap in peace. When the friend returned to the garden with the cool water, the six men rested quietly in the shade and they thought about the Raja's advice. He is right, said the first blind man. To learn the truth, we must put all the parts together. Let's discuss this on the journey home. And so they did. Now is the time in our service where we generally collect donations, and so now is the time online where I tell you to go to our website, uucwf.org, and scroll all the way down to the donate button. Today, it being Mother's Day, and I know we haven't done a special collection except maybe for Hope for a while. And so today I might invite you to go, once you hit the donate button, we now have new options. You can donate to pay your pledge. You can put money into the minister's discretionary fund to help other congregants and folks in need. You can donate money to Hope Food Pantry. And there's another thing that says special collection. Today, I would like to invite you to go to the special collection, and today or this week, any money that comes in through there or comes into the office with a note in the memo line will be given to Clackamas Women's Services. There has been, unsurprisingly, unfortunately, an uptick in domestic violence reports. People are trapped at home together and it is harder. And so let's throw some money towards Clackamas Women's Services today. I am sure that they could use it. Our joys and sorrows today. I can't see the chat today, so I might have to ask Allison and she might help me. First, our joys. So if you have a joy or sorrow, you're welcome to put it in the chat, especially joys right now. Elliot and Marina McIntyre got to celebrate their son David's 53rd birthday this week. They note that his was a difficult birth and in some ways a challenging upbringing to get him to be the fine man that he is today. He continues to work in essential services as a home health aide and tells his folks that he loves his job and that makes his parents very proud. Do you have any other joys?
Nothing to show.
Not yet, okay. On that joy and woe are woven fine note, Julianne Renzema said that she would light candles for her son, Joey, a graduating high school senior who has been struggling with the loss and grief of his senior year in high school. The losses are many, senior prom and music performances, the senior season of Ultimate Frisbee and competing in nationals, the senior trip his class was going to take to Vancouver, British Columbia, and time with his classmates that he spent the last 12 years with at Portland Waldorf School. Graduation, senior week, senior art show, and other meaningful traditions and rites of passage that he and his classmates will miss. Makes Julianne's heart ache. She would light a candle of gratitude for the people who have shown up for him in this difficult time, especially his teachers, Liz Truesdale, Tom Myers, Nina Churchill, and tutor Rochelle Giamatta. They are amazing human beings. And she would light a candle for all the people who live with depression and and are doing the best they can to navigate our new changed world. You are not crazy. The world is upside down, and things will get better.
We've had some joys come in.
Okay.
Sorry to interrupt. From Brian Fassett, Ruby has a joy that they got a new puppy, and she is precious and so cute, and Romeo and Juliet are getting along perfectly.
Yay,
I've seen the pictures.
Maggie is grateful for her daughters-in-law, who are such fine mothers.
Nice.
Mary Kerner Ekstrand is holding Joey and all the high school seniors in our hearts. And from Sheila and Kari, joy that her nephew Dane is getting a volleyball scholarship to Roosevelt University in Chicago.
Wow.
Very
cool.
Pretty cool. A handful of stones in here. Wonderful. I hope you all could hear those. If you couldn't hear them, you could probably read them. Our sorrows are significant today. Mary Knight is sad to report that her son and daughter-in-law are getting a divorce. They have 3 sons, 8-year-old twins, and a 5-year-old. Joan and John Young, who are both recovering from surgery, report that their beloved dog, Avery, was attacked by a Doberman while they were walking her. But Avery is recovering well. And Charles and Anna wish to hold up Ahmaud Arbery, that he was tragically murdered, that the perpetrators were protected, and that it's taken so long to address. The impact that this has had on his family and community. This was truly a tragic event, born, continued, compounded by racism. And we hold Ahmaud and his family and all who suffer in our hearts. And we pour the water in to represent the community that holds all these joys and sorrows. Are there any more sorrows? No? Okay. Will you pray with me? Spirit of life and love, for the joys that we have heard about today, for the bittersweetness of students graduating without the rituals, for the bittersweetness of a puppy hurt but healing, for the sheer joy and sweetness of a new puppy, for the sorrows of divorce, for the sorrow and sin of racism that exists everywhere in our world. And today, for mothers. Today we celebrate mothers and our own complicated relationship with mothers. We honor those people who raised us. We rejoice when they did it well and forgive those times we didn't get the mothering we needed or wanted. We celebrate the children who made us mothers. We acknowledge and honor those who choose not to mother, expending energy into other areas of the world. We sit with the pain of those who wished to mother, but weren't able to for whatever reason. We honor those whose hearts have been broken by the loss of a child. For those of you who conceived children you were unable to raise for whatever reason, we sit with you in their absence today. For those who raise children through birth or fostering or adoption, we celebrate your mothering. For those of you struggling with relentlessness, even amidst the sweetness of mothering young children, we honor you. For those of you facing the joys and struggles of differentiating tweens and teenagers, we honor you. For those of you whose children are grown and still hovering, not yet fully who they will become, we recognize you. For those of you whose children are fully launched, we celebrate your achievements no matter where your children may be. For those of you who mother children in complicated ways through step-parenting and shared co-parenting with exes and nurturing other people's children and nurturing grandchildren, we see the complications that are sometimes present and we honor those deep moments of sweetness we are blessed with. For those of you missing your own mothers today, we mourn with you and honor your loss. For those of you wishing you had been mothered better today, we see your heartache. For those of you kids out there who are blessed with good moms, we celebrate you and pledge our support to your families. May it ever be so. Amen. And blessed be. This is a prayer for parenting in a pandemic. A prayer for the dirty laundry and piled up dishes. A prayer for dance parties and cuddle puddles. For long walks and improvised science experiments. For screen time as education and distraction. This is a prayer for working parents Zooming another meeting with a little face joining in. For new parents waiting for a new life without support. For the single parents doing this all alone. For parents who are on the front lines and essential workers who worry every day about being away from home, about bringing something home, about holding it all together as you hold the world together. This is a prayer for the more than 200 meals you've made, for the 100 millionth time you've heard, "Can I have a snack?" For the 5 minutes of alone time you can squeak out every day. For the 2, 4, 6, 60 gray hairs you've acquired so far. This is a prayer for the meltdowns, the missed naps, the many, many tears. The distance learning homework no one wants to do, but still somehow feel the need to fight about. This is a prayer for wondering if they will ever fall asleep, for wondering if they will ever get up. A prayer for pretending that you're enjoying yourself while you all play their favorite game. This is a prayer for all the missed milestones, for holding your child as they cry over missing their friends, missing their prom, missing their graduation, for your own tears because you can't fix this problem. This is for all the milestones still marked, the public birthday party parades and Zoom proms hosted by celebrities, the family celebrations of learning to walk and the first lost tooth, the private personal celebrations of the many ways you've watched your children grow and mature right close up. This prayer is for all the newly formed family bands and midday pajama-clad dance parties, for all the backyard bathing, for the new trampolines, new bikes, new play structures, a prayer for inside obstacle courses and learning to make new crafts, for all the pets who have joined new families. This is a prayer for bonding and togetherness, for breaking and too much togetherness. This is a prayer for love, for anger, for grief, for time out of time. This is a prayer for parenting in a pandemic. I invite you to sing our doxology. I know this rose will open.
This rose will open. I know.
more than one thing can be true at the same time. For example, if I asked you what color my hair is right now, you would probably say brown. And that's true. It's what's on my driver's license. I have brown hair. But if I asked you what color my hair was when I'm out in the bright sunshine, you would probably say silver or white. And that is very true also. Sometimes, if you look closely at the front, you might even notice the blue. All of these things are true. Like the story of the six blind men and the elephant, many things can be true at the same time. And our perception of things affect how we see or experience them. For the last 2 months, and for the foreseeable future, our lives have changed drastically. We no longer go to concerts or sporting events or church in person, although we may watch some of these things in line. Our kids don't even go to school. Instead, we try to teach them at home or help them to do work online. If we live alone, chances are good we haven't touched another human being in 2 months. Some of us, whose jobs are deemed essential, are still going to work, or we may be fearful of exposure to the virus. Some of us are working from home, trying to balance cooking all of our meals and taking care of our children along with our normal jobs. Some of us have lost our jobs or most of our clients and are trying to figure out how we're going to make it financially. All our perspectives are different, and each of our perspectives, based on our experiences, are true for us. Not every piece of knowledge is true. There are certainly false or misleading information out there. But that's not what I'm talking about today. Today, I am talking about how we can hold multiple perspectives or truths at the same time. One of the things that I have been saying a lot during this time is that it is okay to feel all the feelings. Truly. Some people's experience of this pandemic has been horrific. Over 70,000 people in the United States have died from this disease. And those deaths have been painful and isolated. For folks who get very sick, it is a hellacious experience. Fevers that go on for weeks, struggling for breath, unable to get enough air. Some healthcare workers, especially in New York City, New Orleans, and other areas hit especially hard, are working day in and day out, afraid to get sick, afraid to bring the disease home to their families, watching parents die alone or with only a gloved healthcare worker to hold their hand. It is brutal. And other essential workers are faced with the fear of getting sick or fear of losing their jobs. Amazon warehouse employees, grocery store or drugstore employees, public transit drivers are in many cases fighting for safety equipment and worried about childcare. In the face of all this, knowing what we know, we must stay home. We must keep the disease from expanding more rapidly than it is. And, in the face of all of these experiences, it can be really hard to acknowledge the toll social distancing is having on all of us. We are not homeless, we are not sick, we are not starving. What exactly do we have to complain about? We need to hold on to that gratitude, that gratefulness and responsible behavior. And it is okay to acknowledge the hurting. My sister's husband just retired, and they moved from Kirkland, Washington, just outside Seattle, to Redmond, Oregon, right outside Bend, where his kids and grandkids live. They were looking forward to watching their grandchildren play t-ball and cheering them on at their dance performances and hanging out with them. They were looking forward to decorating their new house. Instead, they are in a nice home, but they are away from all that is familiar. And they don't have any of the new stuff to enjoy. They don't get to snuggle the grandbabies, which is why they moved down there in the first place. As we were talking, my sister quoted me, which I kind of love. She said, "I know I shouldn't complain because we have it so good, but I remember when you said, just because someone somewhere has a brain tumor doesn't mean you never get to complain about your headache." I'm going to say that again. Just because someone somewhere has a brain tumor doesn't mean you never get to complain about your headache. It is good to know your place in things. It is good to be grateful for all that we have. And it is hard to miss out on the rituals of springtime. Kids are missing sports seasons and dances and performances. High school seniors are missing prom and graduations and their senior seasons, this time that was supposed to be the culmination of all of their years in school. Instead, it is the longest senior skip day ever with none of the fun. There is no chance to say goodbye to in person. No chance to hug the teachers that have meant so much to them. To have friends sign their yearbooks. No chance for parents to beam with pride and watch their kids blossom with their peers and celebrate this long, strange adventure that is high school. I think most of us understand and acknowledge these losses. Of course, missing your senior year or even the last 2 or 3 months of school is hard. It's difficult to imagine that anyone would argue with that. Necessary for sure, but still really hard. But here's the thing. It's not a competition. It is okay for you to be disappointed and sad for whatever it is that you are missing, even the smaller things. I am desperately missing friendly interactions with strangers. You know what I mean? Those pleasantries exchanged with the bank teller, the person bagging your groceries, the waitress, the person cutting your hair. Maggie Reed called them consequential strangers in an essay she sent me. Those folks we see at the library, the coffee shop, the person who delivers the mail. That not quite strangers ground us in this time and place, she wrote. We walk in this neighborhood. We shop at that store on Wednesdays. We bide our time in this coffee shop with our special drink and these familiar counter workers. We wave at the mailman and talk about honey with the beekeeper at the farmer's market. My family laughs at me because I can literally come back to the car after being in the bank for 5 minutes and tell you about my conversation with the teller, where we talked about the fact that both of our kids are graduating, but her son isn't going to college because his dad only had like a third grade education, but started his own business and has been doing wonderfully. So her son is going to join his dad in his dad's business, and they're looking forward to that. And my kids roll their eyes and say, "How in the world did you find that out?" There are ways that I am finding my own consequential strangers closer to home these days. I still do my own grocery shopping once a week or so, and when you have $200 worth of food in your cart at Trader Joe's, you can have quite a conversation with the checkout clerk. I talk to my neighbors more than I did before. Greg and Belinda have brought us homemade bread and brownies and let me borrow books. I have brought them carrot cake and angel food cake with strawberries. No one is starving in our house. Our neighbors Nico and Molly had a parade of cars driving past their house a couple of weekends ago, and I went to go see what they were celebrating. And after running into each other on a dog walk again and chatting last week, they brought a box with the graduation banners that they had used so we can celebrate my daughter Mika's college graduation next week. And my kid said, "Mom, you talked to these people for 15 minutes tops, and they know our dog's name." Like, of course, this is the kind of world I want to live in. Once a week or so, I walk down to the neighborhood bakery and buy pastries that I have ordered online. Morgan, one of the owners who works in the front, and I have developed a nice relationship. They're slammed this week because of brunch specials they're running, and so they're taking next weekend off. And she told me, "I said to my partner, Jax, we can run ourselves into the ground, or we can find ways to make this workable and sustainable. I'm hoping that we can come out of this all with a little more compassion for everyone." May it be so. Sometimes I am struggling a bit. I know I am profoundly lucky. I have my partner and my daughters with me. We live in a nice house with plenty of food. My partner and I are both still working, and I love my job and my congregation. I have so much to be grateful for, and I really am. And yet, in order for this to be sustainable, we have to treat ourselves with a little compassion, too. We have to offer ourselves and everyone else a little spaciousness and a little bit of grace. The neighbor kids are going to be loud. Of course they are. Everyone is coping the best way they know how right now. Some parents are finding that a schedule is saving their lives right now. If that's working for you, great. Some parents are finding that they need to let go of the idea that their kids are going to be doing schoolwork. And if that's what works for you, great. You do you. It is okay and perfectly normal to be holding conflicting feelings right now. There are folks out there with small children in the house, and my hunch is, because I've been there, that there are times when you are holding, "I love my kids so much, and I am so grateful for this time we can spend together as a family, and I would chew off my left arm for 5 minutes of alone time right now." And those can both be true at the very same time. We can all just feel one part of the elephant right now. It is good to talk with other people and get ideas about what we might not be seeing. What we know is one part of the truth. A few weeks ago, when I was struggling, I realized that one of the difficult things for me is that everything looks normal. And nothing is normal. When there's a flood or a tornado or an earthquake, nothing looks the same, and so you don't expect anything to be the same. But everything outside my window looks perfectly normal, and it's not. I get nervous when there are too many people gathered together. I get nervous when someone coughs at the post office without covering her face. I get anxious when a stranger comes too close to me. I saw a thing on Facebook, supposedly from Great Britain's National Health Service. It said, "You are not working from home. You are staying home in a crisis, trying to get work done." It also said, "Don't judge other people who aren't coping the same way you are. And don't judge yourself because you aren't coping in the same way other people are." I found that shockingly helpful advice. It is a really good time to be gentle with ourselves and with each other. Our leaning on others is very metaphorical these days, but we are all learning how much we need each other. those people who deliver food or select our groceries or put themselves at risk to stock shelves or deliver the mail or drive people to work, the farmers out in the fields, the teachers trying to teach our kids online, the consequential strangers of our lives who ground us in time and place. Let us be gentle with ourselves and with each other. I do so much better when I am gentle with myself. I invite you to do the same thing. Let us hold on to the both and of different perspectives. We are blessed and lucky. It's really hard. We are doing what needs to be done, and there are painful consequences of lost jobs and lost opportunities and lost rituals. In the words of Ram Dass, we are all just walking each other home. May it be so, my friends. Blessed be, and amen. I invite you into a moment of silence. Rest your feet on the floor if you like. Take a deep breath. Figure out where you need to be gentle with yourselves and each other.
Ride up the road.
chalice extinguishing today. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. Again, I'm going to invite you to stay after the postlude, even if you aren't going to stay for the virtual coffee hour, so we can do a quick practice run through of voting for our Zoom annual meeting to be held next week after the service. As you go from this place, my friends, this metaphorical space that we are in together, even as we sit in our own homes, I think there's something about the fact that the space here that we create is metaphorical. It is in your hearts. It happens when we gather together, however it is that we do that. Be gentle with yourself. Be gentle with everyone else. Remember that we all have one perspective on the truth, and that it takes so many of them to make an elephant. Go in peace and go in love, my friends. Blessed be, and amen.